Good morning, everyone. Good, good. You're all awake. That's good. Nice to know I'm not alone here. So, welcome to all of those of you who have come to this service of praise and worship this morning, either physically in the building, or if you're joining us on Zoom or on Facebook. However you have come here, it is my prayer that you go from here having experienced something of the greatness and the presence of God. I'm Malcolm Hayes, for those of you who may not know me on the outside world. I'm one of the members here and I will be leading the service today. We shall be having a service communion, as you can see, later on. So those of you who are online may wish to have bread and wine or bread and juice, as you wish, ready for that particular point in the service. So some necessary notices first. I'll try and make this as short as possible. You've been seeing them on the screen here, and they are in the newsletter, for which a few paper copies are at the back. The most important one I want to bring your attention to is the open air outreach services on the 11th, 18th and 25th of June, between 3:45 and 4:30 on Christchurch Gardens or Top Park, whichever you want to call it. There will be a barbecue, which will be free to all who pass by. We should be playing some Christian music while that is taking place. And at the end, there will be a very short address and the opportunity for us to join in some congregational singing together. Now, this is really important. It's our opportunity to get out there and get the word of God over to the rest of the world. So please, if you can participate in this, we might need help with the barbecue. I might need some more singers for the band. And we need help getting the physical bits and pieces over there as well. But most importantly, pray. Pray that God will bring along the people he wants to get to through us. And let us pray in faith that lives will be changed by something that people hear as they pass by, or something that we say to them, something that we say during the little speech at the end. However, please pray for this. This work has been prepared for by the work of the chocolatiers who are out on Christchurch Gardens every Tuesday. Please pray for that as well. That is starting to result in some interesting little conversations. I was hearing recently that somebody was inspired to go to a church service as a result of something that they'd heard. And I also bring your attention to the next prayer workshop, which will be in the 16th next Sunday. Please come along. Don't be frightened by the title, workshop. It's where we study items of prayer in the Bible and see what we can draw from it. And we pray together, of course, obviously, for things that concern us about the fellowship. So that's, if you like, the bureaucracy. So let's pause for a moment and remember that the reason we are here is to praise God for no other reason at all. So let's pause and remember who we are in the presence of. So today we come to the latest in our series of messages that we've been having over the last few weeks called Talking with Jesus, based on the parables that Jesus told. This week, the theme is generosity. And Brian Conway, our brother over here, will be bringing us the message based on the parable of the workers in the vineyard and the parable of the two debtors. And these two parables are all about God's generosity. And God's generosity is, as the parable of the vineyard you will see, is completely at odds with the way we think of generosity, which is the whole point, because the parable was told about the kingdom of God. You see, we might be generous to people we like, or family, or friends, or people we think are deserving of our generosity. But God, he's generous to all, regardless. And that's the wonderful thing about it. It doesn't depend on our goodness. It depends on God's generosity. So, let us praise this generous God. For our call to worship, I'm going to use some verses from Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. So let us come and praise God, who is as generous to the last as he is to the first. So we're going to start our worship with some songs. And the first song will be a good old standard hymn. We like to give the organ an airing every now and again. So this is an ideal opportunity. So we start with praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. After each song, I will leave a pause for those of you who wish to contribute your own prayers of praise or words of praise. And do that in whatever language you feel comfortable in. Or, and I put myself out on a limb here, if you feel you're so moved that you think there is another song which would be relevant at this point, then start singing it and we will try and join in with you. So, the hymn celebrates God's generosity to us in that he sent his son Jesus to redeem us from our sins. So let us praise Jesus, who suffered and bled and died for our sins, as we shall recall when we come to communion later. Please sit or stand for these songs as you feel able.
Oh,
Jesus, we praise you that you willingly bore our sorrows. You showed us love unbounded, deep and strong to us while we were still sinners. Help us in response to this great love to praise you ever in joyful song. Amen. We come now to our second song. God is generous to us, as we have been saying. So how do we respond to that generosity? This song says that what we should be doing is offering up our lives in response to this generous God. I will offer up my life.
Father, we stand in your presence, knowing that only by sheerest grace do we enter your courts. Lord, we have sung those words, we have nothing to give, in the room. Lord, we stand here this morning, hollow, empty, and yet wonderful God, you're full. Lord Jesus, Scripture tells us that in you dwell the fullness of the Godhead. Glory to your name. Lord Jesus, by your grace you came and walked on this earth, and by your Spirit you're here with us this morning. Lord Jesus, stir us with that same life that you poured out and that you continue to pour out. Stir us with you, Lord Jesus.
Our final song in this sequence is Christ Be in My Waking. You've actually heard this song 2 weeks ago when the band sung it to you. Hopefully that sort of sunk into your little memory banks and you can remember it. And now it's your chance to sing with the band as we repeat this particular song. It's a prayer that Christ should be in all that we do. And the chorus goes, Jesus, this is my devotion, all my life to know you, every day to walk with you. So let's, as we sing that, let's make that a part of our own particular prayer in response to this song. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you.
seated. And Iris will come to bring us our prayers of intercession.
Good morning. I guess many of you, like me, will have favourite hymns. And when I was thinking about our prayers for others this week, words kept coming into my head from one of my favourites. So I'd like to start our prayers today with some words from Christ Be Our Light, which I think encapsulate what we would all want for our world. So let us bow our heads in prayer. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. But your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others, shared until all are fed. Longing for shelter, many are homeless. Longing for warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others, walls made of living stone. So, Father God, we come to you now with our prayers of intercession. Our prayers for others. We think firstly of our world. The war in Ukraine shows no sign of ending, but we continue to pray for a peaceful end to the conflict there. We remember too all those who have lost their lives in the devastating rail collision in India. We pray for healing and comfort for all those affected. Father, it's so easy for us to focus on the news we see on our TV screens or hear about in the media. But there are many other parts of our world in extreme need where people are experiencing conflict, famine, and persecution. Father God, we remember all those who are suffering persecution because of their faith, because of the colour of their skin, because they do not fit in and are marginalised by society. We think of those who are homeless. We think of those who are without food. We think of those suffering abuse. We ask that they will know that they are loved and prayed for and not forgotten. We know, Father, that you see and understand all this suffering and inequality in our world. Help us, Father, to examine our own behaviours and attitudes. Help us to be mindful of the impact that our behaviours can have on those around us. May we be tolerant and kind, especially towards those we find difficult or whose values and views are not ours. Within our nation, we remember the families of the two young people who died last week on Bournemouth Beach. We ask for peace for their loved ones in the coming days and pray that they will feel your comforting, healing presence in their lives. Within our fellowship here in Leamington, we remember those in need of prayer at this time. We think of Jane Jones recovering from surgery this week. May she know that we are thinking of her with love. We ask that recovery will be swift and that she will feel able to be with us again soon. We remember our friends Mandy and Paul Boyce as they make their way home to the UK after living in America for some years. The coming days and weeks will see significant changes in their life. Reassure them, Father, that their decision is the right one. We pray that they will quickly settle back to life here. We remember Sally Rogers and her family, who have concerns about Sally's mum. Help them, Father, through this anxious time. We pray too for all our friends who are no longer able to attend church. May they know they are not forgotten and that we do think of them. We continue to give thanks for the continuity of church life here. Our search for a new minister is ongoing, but we are thankful that we're able to continue to worship and praise you in this place. We give grateful thanks to all those who make this happen. We place our trust in you, Father, that when the time is right, you will make a new minister known to us. We ask for your blessings on the open-air services that will take place in the coming Sundays. We pray that they will be a time of joy and praise to your glory. It is our hope that they will provide an opportunity for us to share your love with those beyond our fellowship. Finally, Father, we ask that you will help us to remember all that is good in our lives. It's very easy to focus on things that are not going well, but we have much to be grateful for, most especially the knowledge that you love each and every one of us and that that love is unconditional. We take comfort from knowing that you are with us every step of the way through life's journey. Now, each one of us, Father, will have those who are on our hearts at the moment. And in the silence that follows, we bring these to you in our individual prayers for others. Thank you, Father, for hearing us. May your light shine on us all through this coming week. Amen.
We have two Bible readings this morning, and they are both from the New Testament, and you can find them in the church Bibles on pages 18 and 57, respectively. The first reading is from Matthew, chapter 20, reading verses 1 to 16. The kingdom of heaven is like this. There was once a landowner who went out early one morning to hire labourers for his vineyard. And after agreeing to pay them the usual day's wage, he sent them off to work. 3 hours later, he went out again and saw some more men standing idle in the marketplace. "Go and join the others in the vineyard," he said, "and I will pay you a fair wage." So off they went. At midday, he went out again, and at 3 PM, and made the same arrangement as before. An hour before sunset, he went out and found another group standing there. So he said to them, "Why are you standing here all day long, doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they replied. So he told them, "Go and join the others in the vineyard." When evening fell, the owner of the vineyard said to the overseer, "Call the labourers and give them their pay, beginning with those who came last and ending with the first." Those who had started work an hour before sunset came forward and were paid the full day's wage. When it was the turn of the men who had come first, they expected something extra, but were paid the same as the others. As they took it, they grumbled at their employer. "These latecomers did only 1 hour's work, yet you have treated them on a level with us, who have sweated the whole day long in the blazing sun." The owner turned to one of them and said, "My friend, I'm not being unfair to you. You agreed on the usual wage for that day, did you not? Take your pay and go home. I choose to give the last man the same as you. Surely I am free to do what I like with my own money. Why be jealous because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first last." The next reading is from Luke chapter 7, reading verses 41 to 43. Two men were in debt to a moneylender. One owed him 500 silver pieces, the other 50. And as they didn't have the means to pay, he cancelled both debts. "Now, which will love him more?" Simon replied, "I should think the one that was let off more." "You are right," said Jesus. Thanks be to God for his word.
Now Brian will come and read us and give us God's message based on the readings that we have heard. I can just pray with you before you start, Brian. Wait for Chris to sort the mechanics. There you go. Father, we bring Brian before you. We ask that you will guide him in the words that he chooses to use, the message that he brings us. We ask that you will open our hearts to receive that message, our minds to understand, and our will to do what you are calling us to do through Brian. Amen.
Thank you, Malcolm, very much indeed. Good morning, everybody. Nice to see so many bright, shining faces looking back. Thank you very much for your welcome, everybody, this morning. We were here about 6 or 7 months ago, and we remember it very well, Leamington Baptist. It's got a good reputation in many areas beyond Leamington and Warwick. So great to be here. What a wonderful subject, isn't it? Generosity. Wow, we're going to have a look at the readings that we've just heard, particularly the parable of the vineyard in a moment. But yeah, generosity illustrates our great God, because hopefully by the end of the time here, we will see what a wonderful, incredible, generous God that we have. But just to illustrate things, let me start off by illustrating generosity by giving you the story, a rather amusing story, of a little three-year-old boy and his mother who go into a supermarket. And as they're going in, she says to him, "Now, don't you get asking for any chocolate chip biscuits, because I'm not going to be buying any." So in they go, and they're wandering around, and after a short while, he turns around and says, "Can I please have some chocolate chip biscuits?" The mother says, I've already told you, you've had far too many anyway. No, I'm not going to be buying any today. So they go on a little bit further, and he says again, "Can I have some chocolate chip biscuits?" The mother says, "Young man, how many times have I got to tell you? I'm not going to be buying any. That's it. Period. Finished." Anyway, the shopping is done and they're making their way towards the checkout. And as they do, they have to pass down the aisle where these chocolate chip biscuits are. So the little three-year-old, realizing that this was his last opportunity, shouts at the top of his voice so everybody can hear, "In the name of Jesus, can I please have some chocolate chip biscuits?" Talk about putting mum on the spot. Anyway, some people in the supermarket laughed, others applauded, but due to the generosity of a lot of folk inside that supermarket, mother and the little three-year-old went home with 23 packets of chocolate chip biscuits. Generosity, friends. And if you've got children or you've ever worked with children, you've probably heard the following three words again and again. It's not fair. It's not fair that my sister gets to stay up later than me. It's not fair that you bought my brother a car. It's not fair that they get to go to the dance and I don't. And it seems from a very early age, we develop a fairness meter in our brains that is constantly on the lookout for unfairness in our world. But it's not just children who say these words, friends. As adults, we may think of them just as often as the little ones, but the situations become more difficult and tragic to understand, getting very serious now. You can say it's not fair when a mother and child are killed by a drunk driver. You can say it's not fair not being able to conceive when you see people celebrating with their babies. Childhood cancer isn't fair. Losing a spouse isn't fair. Favoritism isn't fair. Hypocrisy isn't fair. It isn't fair when people who have no love for God thrive and become rich and powerful. Several people say bad things happen to good people. Well, I'm reminded of someone responding to this, and he said, "Well, that's only happened to one person," and he volunteered. We all know who we're talking about, don't we? And as my children were growing up and would whine, "It's not fair," I always used to respond, "Well, life's not fair, and I'm not Santa Claus." To which my eldest child, at about 8 years of old, said, "Well, my theory is that you are." Over a third of all Jesus' teaching was done in parables. And they're designed to be subversive. They give us the opportunity to think deeply and try to work out what Jesus is trying to get at. In Matthew chapter 18, Jesus encounters what we have come to call the rich young ruler. He was a wealthy young man who asked Jesus, "What good thing must I do to inherit eternal life?" And he was curious, and Jesus told him to keep the commandments, and this young man assured Jesus that he had. So Jesus looked at him and said, "Well, if you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and then come and follow me." And the young man considered Jesus' proposal and then turned and walked away because he had great wealth. Jesus wasn't teaching that having wealth was bad. The young man didn't own his stuff. The problem was his stuff owned him. And Jesus had to rid him of it. His wealth was idolatry, and Jesus uncovered it. He said, "Truly I say to you, it is hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle." I always used to words on that one when I was a kid. "Now, for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples, confused and astonished, said, well, who then can be saved? And Jesus said, well, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. And this prompted a question from Peter. Now, Peter was never shy about asking questions. And Peter answered him, well, we've left everything to follow you. What then will there be for us? Let me read that again. What will there then be for us? There is something wrong with Peter's heart posture here towards Jesus. Do you hear it? It's almost as though he's saying, look how much I've done for you. What's in it for me? And Jesus responded to the group. Jesus said to them, truly, I tell you, with the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging as the 12 tribes of Israel. As everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or fields, or children, for my sake, will receive 100 times as much and will inherit eternal life. And then he sets up the parable that we're going to be looking at with these cryptic words. But many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. The parable of the vineyard. Let's go through the parable briefly. I'll make some observations along the way, and then we can look at some applications. For the kingdom of heaven, said Jesus, is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them. In some translations of the Bible, it says a denarius for the day, and sent them into his vineyard. 30 times in Matthew, the phrase "the kingdom of heaven" is found. It simply means the reign and rule of King Jesus. When we are introduced to the characters in the story, God is the landowner, we are the workers, and the vineyard is the world in which we can serve him. The landowner obviously had a large vineyard of, I don't know, maybe grapes or something, that needed to be harvested quickly. He went out at the start of the day, 6 a.m. in the morning, shall we say, to the market to hire day laborers to work in his vineyard. Apparently, this is still the custom in many places in the world. Anyway, he did find people who were willing to come along. And they agreed to work for a denarius, which was a day's wages. I'll tell you what, though, friends, for our purpose this morning, we're going to say £100, all right? About 9 o'clock in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. So he tells them, you also go and work in my vineyard, and I'll pay you what is right. So off they went. Notice that there wasn't a contract agreement. It's almost as though they trusted the landowner. They must have heard that he was fair. So he goes out again about noon. Then he goes out again about 3 in the afternoon. And he asks, well, why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing? These are to the 5 o'clockers. He goes out at 5 o'clock or thereabouts. And they turn around and says, well, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you also go and work in my vineyard. Now, these workers who joined right at virtually the end of the day weren't lazy. It's just that they hadn't had the opportunity to work. The landowner even went back at 5. And by the time this group got back to the vineyard, it was almost time to end the day's work. Maybe they did about an hour or something. And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first. The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received £100. The landowner asked his foreman do a curious thing. He is to pay the ones that were just hired, the ones who only worked for an hour or thereabouts, and they received £100. Can you imagine the 6 a.m.ers rubbing their hands with glee? Wow, hey, these guys have hardly even done anything. They've got 100 quid. Hey, wonderful. So we read that when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more, but each of them only received also £100. When they received it, they started to grumble. These who were hired last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day. So the 6 a.m. guys, the ones who had borne the brunt of the work in the hot sun all day, saw the 11th hour guys get £100, begin to get excited, and they think, well, if they're getting £100 doing next to nothing, what are we now going to get? Anticipation. But the foreman handed each man exactly the same amount, £100. At this, they begin to grumble, and we've heard the reading. Maybe they would have called their union representative because of the unfairness had such a person or such a situation existed in those days. But the landowner says, I'm not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired the same as you. Don't I have the right to do what I want to do with my own money? Or are you envious because I'm generous? Coming to the generosity bit, the landowner isn't mad. In fact, he calls them friend. But he does ask three very important questions. Did you not agree to work for £100? Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Are you envious because I am generous? Remember that the people listening to this parable would have immediately understood that the 11th hour people were the Gentiles, the tax collectors, the prostitutes. As Jewish people, the Jews had the promises of God and a relationship with him that went back thousands of years. But Jesus was now opening that relationship up with the Gentiles, and they, the Jews, were screaming in their hearts, that's not fair. It was a heart posture problem that Peter exhibited in his in question, what's in it for us? Basically, the workers were saying to the landowner, give us what we deserve, which is a very dangerous thing to say to God, because the only thing we deserve is destruction. He ends the parable in the way he begins it, and so the last will be first, and the first will be last. Stories told of a pastor in America. And the story he told was this. He said, when one of my sons was about 6 years old, he became fascinated with the fan. Fan as an electric appliance and sort of goes around, keeps you cool on a hot day, that sort of fan. It was a stand-up fan, and he would put a pencil in the blaze to hear the sound that it made. And he was told multiple times not to do this until one day he actually broke the fan. So the pastor said, well, when I drove into the driveway, he met me at the car and said, I didn't mean it, Daddy. It was an accident. Please don't punish me. My wife, whom I had already let her know what had happened, and I decided to use this to teach a lesson. I asked him if he deserved to be punished, and he said yes. I told him that he wasn't going to get what he deserved. Getting what you deserve is justice. Not getting what you deserve is mercy. And I showed him mercy that night. And then I took a step further. I took him to Dairy Queen and got him an ice cream cone. And that was grace. Grace is getting what you don't deserve. And my son learnt more on that particular day from what was done than anything else that was around. Friends, grace means quite simply that no one is too bad to be saved. It can mean also that some people are too good to be saved. Those who think that they don't need God's grace will in the end get what they deserve, justice. Do any of us, including me, have a contract mentality with God? Peter had one. See, look all that I've done for you, Jesus. I deserve more than what you're giving me. He's almost like he was saying. And instead of understanding that everything he had was because of grace, his heart posture was not what it should have been. Got five quick questions to see if any of us have a contract mentality with God, just very briefly. First of all, bitterness. Are we bitter because God has withheld some blessing from us that we think we deserve? As we grow older, we have a choice. We can grow bitter or we can grow better. Let's be careful demanding that God gives us what we think we deserve. Some people told Jesus about a group of Christ followers that Pilate had executed. You probably know the scripture. Jesus responded, do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the tower in Siloam fell on them, do you think that they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will perish. In other words, any day that a tower doesn't fall, your one is a good day. Perhaps we find ourselves saying, look how much I've done for you, God. Why didn't I get that job? Why didn't she say yes? Why didn't I get that promotion? Why didn't we win that game? Jealousy. What is the root of this thinking? Foolish pride that assumes God owes us something, certain things, and unbelief in the goodness of God who was promised to take over us can be a problem. Jesus said, do not let your heart envy sinners, but always be zealous for the fear of the Lord. There is surely a future hope for you, and your hope will not be cut off. Actually, it's not Jesus, that one, it's in Proverbs. If Jesus didn't complain when he received a life infinitely worse than he deserved, how can we complain when we experience a life infinitely better than what we do deserve? Anger. Do I get angry when God doesn't answer my prayers the way I think he should? The same pastor I quoted a couple of 3 minutes ago said, he said, once I took a long bike ride and ended up in a field in the middle of nowhere. I got off my bike and decided to have it out with God. He had not held up his end of the bargain. He hadn't answered my prayers the way I thought he should. So I jumped up and down and I yelled, and I may even have said a few cuss words. When my temper tantrum was over, I sat quietly in the field, half waiting for the lightning bolt that would finish me off. Instead, I noticed a butterfly flitting around me. And when the kids were little, we taught them that whenever they saw a butterfly, it meant that God was watching over us. That butterfly reminded me that God wasn't punishing me. He punished Jesus in my place. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, as Paul said to the church at Rome. And he hadn't forgotten me. I could trust his heart even when I couldn't follow his hand, I noticed as I saw this butterfly. Sometimes we can find ourselves mad at God for not answering prayers he never made. Insecurity. Do I feel uncertain about where I stand with God or insecure about the future? Have we ever thought to ourselves, have I been good enough for God to love me? Or thought, I didn't do my quiet time this morning, so God is disappointed in me. Or maybe God will eventually get sick of me and cast me aside. Perhaps we have. That's proof that we don't understand, though, what grace of God actually is. Am I good enough? Not even close. But being good enough doesn't get me to heaven. God demands perfection and we fail the test. Jesus took the test. He made an A+, and then he applied his grade to my report card. In Christ, we are forgiven, loved, accepted. It's not about what we do, but about what Christ Jesus has done for us. That's what our faith is about, friends. It's about what he has done for us. We can never, ever outgive God, no matter what. Jesus said that many will say to him, Lord, Lord, but he will tell them to depart because he didn't know them. Our very own, because it's Baptist church, our very own Charles Spurgeon said that Jesus could never say that to him. He says, because when I was hopelessly condemned with guilt, I looked to you to be my righteousness, he said to the Lord. When I felt weak and had fallen again and again into sin, I looked to you and said, you have to be my strength. And when I felt lost, I said that you've got to be my way. And when I felt dead, I said that you have to be my life. And finally, indifference. Am I moved towards action by the suffering of others? Have I ever found myself saying something like, those people deserve what they're getting? Woe on me if I have. Have I judged people in my heart for decisions that they've made? Those guys coming back to the parable who were hired first and had worked all day looked at the 11th hour guys and said, that isn't fair, that's ridiculous. They've been lazy, they've hung out all day doing nothing whilst we worked and they got the same pay. Has my heart grown cold towards others who were suffering because they sin differently than I do? This is the heart posture of the older brother in the parable of the prodigal son. I'm not going to read it all the way through. I trust most of you know it fairly well. The younger brother asks for inheritance and he goes to a far off country, wastes it completely. He decides to return home, and when he does, the father runs to him and orders that the fatted calf be killed and a party held for his wayward son. But the older brother, old misery guts, who in the parable represents the Pharisees, refused to attend. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. And so his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, look, all these years, Dad, I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat to share with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, come home, you kill the fatted calf for him. Doesn't seem fair, but what a generous man was father. The father replies, much like the landowner, my son, he says, you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. Is my heart so cold that I could not celebrate when an 11th hour sinner comes home? Can you imagine with me, I don't know, maybe one or two of the disciples standing at the foot of the cross? And they look at Jesus and then to the men on each side of him, two thieves crucified either side. Maybe their hearts scoffed at them and would tell you that they were getting what they deserved. But then Jesus says a most remarkable statement to one of the men. Today you will be with me in paradise. I'm sure everyone here knows that story. If we could have just listened to the disciples' heart, maybe one or two, they go, what? Wait a minute. That's not fair. We've given everything to you for the last 3 years. Everything we've served, we've gone hungry, we've traveled from town to town, we've taught in Sunday school, we've given hilariously and generously. What has this criminal done to deserve paradise? Absolutely nothing. They still didn't get it. And they didn't get it until the day of Pentecost came. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and they were completely renewed, totally new human beings, if you like. And wow, what did they do then? They went out and did amazing things for God. But it's incredible when you realize, when you read various instances of them being with Jesus through those 3 years, that even at the end of time, they didn't get things. They were arguing things like, which one of us is the greatest? Can you imagine that, say in Leamington Baptist Church? You know, the guys here are saying, well, which one of us is the greatest? Well, I'm the greatest because I do this, and oh, I'm the greatest. Crazy, absolutely crazy. They just weren't quite up to speed, were they? But they were in a big way thereafter. To finish now, coming towards the end, Philip Yancey, there's a guy called Philip Yancey. He's got a book, What's So Amazing About Grace is what it's called. In it, the guy points out that part of our problem is the nature of grace itself. Grace is scandalous. It's hard to accept, hard to believe, hard to receive. Grace shocks us in what it offers. It's truly not of this world. It frightens us with what it does for sinners. But grace, friends, teaches us that what God does do for others and what we would never do for them. We would save the not so bad, perhaps. God starts with prostitutes and then works downwards from there. Grace is a gift that costs everything to the giver and nothing to the receiver. It's given to those who don't deserve it, barely recognize it, and hardly appreciate it. That's why God alone gets the glory in our salvation. Jesus did all the work when he died on the cross. And that was the most generous thing that anybody, any entity has ever done for anybody and ever will. when the Lord, when our God sent his Son to die on that cross for us, what we deserved, that was the most amazing example of generosity, if we want to look at it like that, that there could ever be. And just a few words on the other reading that we read, the story of the generous moneylender. It's only going to take a minute to just mention this. Quite briefly, the moneylender was prepared to forget the debts of two guys. One owed 500, the other one owed 50. And so he says to the Pharisee who had invited him for the meal, which one was the most generous of the two? It's a bit of a no-brainer, isn't it, really? And the guy, of course, answers correctly, well, the one who owed him the most. The God that we have, friends, is someone, as we said, we can never outgive. We can't. But we have the most incredible, the most amazing God because of what he did for us. I know we've all heard the story time and time again. We've probably heard it since childhood. Yes, we know it, blah, 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 blah. Never let's lose the wondrousness of what he actually did for us, the most generous act ever given to humanity. And let's forever praise him for it. Amen.
Thank you, Brian. So we'll take a moment perhaps to think about what we've learned about the nature of God and his generosity towards us, this amazing generosity which we completely do not deserve. So we come to our next song. We shall shortly be coming to communion. And as preparation for that, we're going to sing As We Are Gathered. The song says that we need to be aware that as we gather, Jesus is here among us. So stay seated for this song, I think. And sing it through twice, but sing it through prayerfully. And let us ask that we can feel the presence of Jesus among us. He is, we are here with us all the time. We may not be aware of his presence though sometimes. So as we are gathered. So we come to communion. Communion is open to everyone here who loves the Lord Jesus. If you are unsure of your relationship with Jesus, just let the bread and wine pass you by as it comes. The bread is gluten-free and the wine is non-alcoholic, so there is no barrier to participation. We need to come to this table in the right frame of mind, as it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. So let us do this and remove anything from our thoughts that would hinder us, as we have sung earlier, as we are gathered, Jesus is here. God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Come to this table not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because of any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. The institution of communion is recorded in 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Reg will now lead us in a prayer of thanks for the bread and the wine.
Shall we pray? Dear God, this morning we come as brothers and sisters in Christ to remember the sacrifice of your only Son, Jesus. We come now to give thanks to you for all the good things and blessings you have given to us throughout our lives, and how we are able to pass on these blessings to others in your name. We come to the table before you to take part in a simple meal of remembrance of his death. We use the wine as the spilled blood and the bread for his body that was broken for us. We eat these things in your name and in remembrance. Amen.
Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body, broken for you." Take this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by thanksgiving. We shall eat the bread as we receive it. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me." We shall retain the cup and drink together as a sign of our fellowship. During the distribution of the wine, the band will sing, "Jesus, stand among us." Please stay seated and just listen to the words and reflect on them as the wine is distributed. Drink this and remember that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Your death, O Lord, we commemorate. Your resurrection, we confess. Your final coming, we await. Glory to be to you, O Christ. Amen. Our final song is "All I Once Held Dear." We have celebrated the Lord's death until he comes again. And this song reflects that. Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your sufferings, to become like you in your death, my Lord, so with you to live and never die. Knowing you, Jesus, there is no greater thing. Let us stand and sing "All I Once Held Dear." God, my all, you are my best. Lord, as you've been generous beyond measure to us, may we be generous in giving of our time and our love to others and giving in your service in this church. Amen. Let's finish our service by saying the grace to each other. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.